Alice Sabotnick as a visitor. She, I met her when we were doing work on the Berlin Biennial and trying to get a read on what it was like to come here and do the lecture. She said, well, just start with a photo of your baby. Like, that'll get, that's a real, I'm a fairly new father. She's a year and a half, you know. So start with all of your baby photos, which are on the computer as well. That's a good start, but you know, you need something to break the ice. So I found this. This is something that is not my baby, but is equally infantile piece I did when I was 17, and it was my. And then, fortunately, we'll skip a lot of years after that. But it seemed to encapsulate actually a lot of strangely things that I. Thanks. That I would end up doing later. In a little more of a decrepit form, but this was my, when I applied to Cooper Union, there's a, you have to do a self-portrait, and they give you these very specific rules about the size. It has to fit in this very small area, and they wanted a full-figure self-portrait.
Was it in costume?
Sorry?
Was it in costume?
I definitely took it to be, I took the whole, you know, this was at the end of a whole slew of college applications, and I was really fed up with this kind of trying to compress a personality into an 8.5 by 11 sort of format, and I didn't feel that I could draw at all. I had no ability to draw, and Cooper was really sort of well known for, yeah, you've got a talent. Well, I didn't really feel like I had any of that, so I had to sort of trick my way into it. I came up with this this sort of art, this G.I. Joe figure that I sort of sculpted. You know, I kind of like sanded all the muscles off him and made him into a portrait of myself in some kind of bizarre way. And there's a really, it comes with a lot of information. Wait a second, here we go. I don't want that. There we go. I think the only thing that really saved it was that stupid hat I put on there, you know. And there's a paintbrush. And so this was sort of an art, sort of this silly art persona that I had come up with. And on the back, I just modified a few of the words, some of the wording on the back, and it said, you know, they came with these little collector cards you could have. It said, Monahan was born and raised in a studio. Went to school in a museum and spent most of his art career sneaking around other countries' museums with a paintbrush in his hand. He can low crawl through the nastiest black water, stinking mud, and bubbling slime for a week, with half his body covered in leeches and the other half raw with bug bites, and still make an opening or critique with polished brass, spit-shine shoes, razor creases, and a mean look in his eye. That's an artist. And then all the other collectibles that you could have were all art world characters, and it was quite a. I even, you know, for 17, it was a pretty precocious kind of list I had assembled. I had all the notable art heroes of the time. I even had Charles Saatchi on there, and you know, some of the, I had LA artists. I had I think Burton was number one. Chris Burton was a big. I was a big fan of Chris Burton, but I also was really into all these 80s painters. So I kind of went into art school with this very sort of open-minded, you know, I liked the big painter guys, I liked the conceptual people. But when I got to school, it was definitely more, you know, New York was much more battlefields. The battle lines were much clearer, and it seemed the separation of the rational and sort of the political and the sensual, really, everything was really split. And I pretty much went into a four-year sort of an extremely critical time where I was pretty much just holed up in the library trying to get through, you know, all these names they were dallying around with deconstruction and all this stuff. I really went in there and it really corroded me on a deep, you know, very beautiful writers involved in it. But it was not the kind of thing that let you go in and make things. So I was much more in a sort of I took this level of criticism to almost a very Spartan, kind of almost a spiritual degree, I think. A lot of other people were somehow able to make these kind of identity politics kind of things, and they somehow were able to mobilize it. But for me, when I took it really seriously, the kind of attack on, you know, the kind of the critique of the sign, you know, the impossibility of expressivity, of, you know, the expressive fallacy and narcissism and all this sort of barrage of things. I was really, I kept trying to find a still way to squeak a piece out and say virtually nothing. It was sort of like, this is the time of no reply. Like, if I can't. So my whole sense of faith at youth was pretty much dried up by then. Somehow I managed to get into a graduate program in Holland. This is me on an early arrival there. I'm taking you through the school thing because I think it's kind of interesting to see how, you know, because you're in this kind of a position. For me, this graduate program is probably the place where I really found my soul again. And it had something to do with the youth of that G.I. Joe guy, with this artist hero figure, this possibility to make figures, and to not to be ashamed to be in the world and say you're an artist, not to be ashamed to make things. And so there was like I felt like it was sort of like a waking. It was like a mature childhood that I was allowed to enter in. We were given these huge studios in this really old building where Mondrian had actually been a school in. And this is a nice photo I found probably in the first couple of months of the place. And truly still pretty disgruntled. But in the back, I had a lot of foam stuff that I'd been collecting, and it was such an incredible transitional moment that there was a point I went back to my little apartment. You know, I was cut loose of all the culture that I knew, all the cool stuff that I knew was pretty much irrelevant. I had these old Dutch guys walking in with their cigars, you know, and I didn't know who anyone was. Some of them were really important conceptual artists at the time. And they were strangely enough supporting me to go in this very sort of this direction. This one teacher said, that's you, you can throw the rest away. And the studio was built. I mean, I'd burned through my stipendium already. I was already broke. I was like, this is great. This is great. You know, I had friends coming over, bringing big bags of marijuana and stuff. It was Amsterdam, you know. But there was a whole excessive, but I bottom lined it. I flatlined real quick there. And hit again, like, dude, what are you gonna do now? You know, I ended up going back to the apartment. I was breaking up with my girlfriend. So I kind of made this little drawing as an attempt to win back my girlfriend. And it obviously, you know, this guy's not equipped to win back in my So, but he definitely, he won back my heart. He charmed me greatly. And I sort of fell in love with this little character, and he pointed the way to, his face just really did me in. He's probably the first piece, the first thing I had made in, you know, maybe 6 years that actually kind of touched me in some sad ass. It generally seemed to be the sad side of things that was touching to me. And I was very influenced by the Flemish primitives, the whole, approach to the old masters, going to Europe, it was like I learned to see again. Suddenly, textures and colors, and things that seemed to, at art school, have absolutely no bearing on anything, was like, hey, that's kind of cool. Like, how did you do that? It was basically a born again experience I was going through. I had these two buddies from England who had also been through similar rigors at Central Saint Martin, and. We sort of developed this pact, this gang. These guys, we called ourselves the Crows. Kind of after this, the Crows in the Van Gogh painting, you know, like the last painting he made. And also one of the guys kind of looked bird-like. So we entered into this funny mythological, kind of, it was jokey, there's a lot of humor in there, but we took it real seriously. And we had this, we had these sort of rules, like you could not use any found objects in your work. You could not use any photography. You could not use any. The work couldn't be about arranging. The work couldn't be about presentation. The work, and it went basically everything we'd acquired in art school. All of our hip tools we used were totally irrelevant. And so this, we put ourselves in this kind of extreme poverty. Did I do all right? And this poverty really led me to figure out, well, what can I draw? Can I draw something? Well, what would I don't want to draw a thing. I don't want to, it was, can I draw, basically, can I draw a face? Was really the starting point of it. And it seemed, well, if I can't use a source, I would have to develop a way to create an imaginary face that would have, so they were basically constructed out of various tropes of drawing that I vaguely remembered from school. And then, so I had all this incredible pressure of my criticism, of feeling that it was impossible that it was virtually stupid to attempt to draw a face. I mean, what an irrelevant kind of thing to attempt, and all this pressure, and then this very minimal tool. And I think the pressure of that task, and the simplicity, created these like just kind of like corroded faces, so that I would draw so much that it would start tearing into the paper, and the paper became this weird damaged skin, and this, they became these very morbid, damaged characters. And this was nothing I initially set out to do. It was a very modest task. I'll do it. So it's a lot of these very weird, dark, there were some dark forces coming upon us. But we were in a very safe environment to let that out in. This is just, you know, these are just this charcoal and paper and chalk. That's about, this was about 2 feet. And then people were already professors with references to different art, but for the most part, I wasn't really concerned with that. I was actually dealing with a real bout of hypochondria during the Dutch winter. And the distance between me and my work was really shrinking. So I'm getting frightfully close to these things. And there was very little critical type of discourse about things that you could talk about things. You were living these things. Which is really a scary, starts to get to be a scary place to be. But I felt that the figure was only, could somehow only emerge in a damaged state. It was that, I feel that there was even a moment, I just remember this the other day from undergraduate school, some guy had made this really terrible, only piece of figurative sculpture I ever saw at Cooper in those 4 years was a really terrible like plaster figure. And probably the most important, most philosophical sculpture teacher, I actually saw her go up and kick it. And I was like stunned. I mean, this was so, in a way, we all thought it was funny. But it was also, when I thought about it, it was so hard. Anyway, she stepped on these and she kicked these. And that's where I felt that artistically and figuratively, that's the place of the figure. People were doing figurative things like Charlie Ray was doing things. But they were, again, based on the mannequin. They were based on altering the mass produced. And they had this kind of protective ironic distance. I just said, what if you just started from the ground up again? And it just seemed like the most novel, the most stupid idea, the most novel thing you could ever think to do. And it opened up the whole field of art history for me. Everything just, I could see art again. You could go to the Louvre one time and you would just look at the way they did like eyebrows. And the next time you'd look at the shoulders, and it was like every painting, the amount of knowledge, conceptual knowledge, visual knowledge, and technique packed into these paintings was just, still, to this day, I can go back to some of my old favorites and just be like, how did they react? The manipulation of space. It just seemed like an encyclopedia of knowledge, visual knowledge, despite all, you know, even all the other iconography and all that stuff aside. I also discovered floral foam there, which is, Holland has a big Dutch, there's a big culture of flower arranging there, and they have these kind of amazing foam you can fill with water. So I made this guy, this is a little rat-like figure. I think probably very influenced by the Bruegels that I was looking at. His eyes are matchsticks, and his teeth are matchsticks. And then he's got, tape and foam, but this this is a little guy, but he stuck with me for years and ended up actually 10 years later in my show at Anton Kern, and became sort of a little talisman in my oeuvre. This is also a foam. These guys are just kind of lounging on the lawn. Holland is very green and soaked. It's sort of on the golf course. And this was a tiny little thing that would sit on the floor. So there's absolutely no heroism in these. Even though my sense was this was kind of the masterpiece in the first year that it, this is crazy. I took a photo last night of the photo, an old photo. But this is about a 15 foot or maybe a 20 foot figure. And this one came very very. This one really summed up the state that I was in. Sort of it's. It was originally a figure on his knees drawing. So the figures, nothing was really about any. There were never really pictures onto something else. They were more about the action. The figure, in a way, they still have this about the action of trying to embody oneself, or trying to hold one's body together. This was one of the more graceful versions in my whole, it's a little bit cheesy for that reason, but the wonder of discovering the power of the hand, or some kind of, and the way that, and then this kind of the supplication towards a, I felt like I was very much supplicating myself to a larger task. So I was very, like, I would spend like drawing on the floor like 8 hour days, like 10 hour days. So we were like in this monastery, we were just like in our studios all the time. On our knees, just making it was cold, and we got really into this cult of this sort of old world cult of, the cloister. And this was my sort of cloister. But then there's this this floating that really fit the, because we never paid a phone bill, we were totally detached from it. And this one was where I definitely worked too long on this one. This was maybe like a 2 month thing. And the head started out about this big originally, and that face now is about that big. So things, the initial joy of making sort of had gotten so decrepit and so morbidly shrinking in upon itself. But not particularly a dreadful photo, but not a particularly good piece, but definitely central to my, like, how far could one take that attempt at perfection? It just turned into the most rotten. Like, one teacher was like, "Oh, maybe a little bit too decadent." No, he liked the other one because it was like decadent, had some ornamental like Asian thing about it. He's like, "This one maybe too decadent," and it did. It became just a rotten old. So then I went on. I went back to California for the summer. Spent some time in the sun. And came back shortly afterwards, and kind of had this breakthrough with these guys, where I had quite an accidental way of sort of developing this double-sided carbon paper using oil paint, and I would slip this in between, fold it around, and do this drawing on the back like a Rorschach, and then it would multiply itself like a Rorschach. So whereas the other figures were like shrinking. This was sort of expanding, sort of exploding, and really all the methods when you are making from no model, when your only model is these sort of artificial constructions. I was building these artificial figures, so here I couldn't erase, so everything showed, and every gesture was actually multiplied. So I went from this subtractive decay to this kind of expansive multiplication. Which is totally, pretty soon the walls of the studio, like up 20 feet high, were just, these guys were running up. I could do three a day. It was just incredibly fruitful, inventive. And they started out in this more topographical way. And then I developed more and more obscure sort of notational systems, more and more odd ways of building. This is about 12 feet high. So there were these long scrolls, and it was a sort of an automatic process where I couldn't really see what I was doing. So I was just translating these. It was like force and structure in an ideal match of force and structure. So they had this sort of pseudo rational appearance, but they were these very just seemingly endless amount of structures could be spiraling out of my hands. You know? And it was really a happy time and this guy on the side here. I wonder how I can get rid of this thing on the bottom. Chris,
you'll go. It should go away when you.
Oh God. Oh no.
Go back to play.
Thank you.
And then just don't keep your cursor on that end here.
See how truly slow I'm going. I only have like 300 more images to go. Graduate school's almost over. You can do it.
Nice recap.
Yeah, right. Like,
what you're going through is, Matthew, I can ask you a question.
Sure.
Like, your sense of the period of time that you were in graduate school, what graduate school was like in the States on both coasts. I mean, do you feel that there really would have been an opportunity or things would have worked in a direction that would have benefited your thinking if you hadn't been in such a kind of unique and isolated environment? In terms of being able to reach, not only reach the figure, but also have that, I mean, that kicking action, that kind of flowed all the way up into every U.S. graduate school at that time.
Yeah, I can imagine, yeah.
I would imagine, yeah, so.
Kicking action?
What you had said, the teacher at Cooper kicking the figure on the ground.
Yeah.
That attitude.
Yeah. No, I don't know if it could have happened. And frankly, it was a lot to do with the guys I was hanging out with the pros.
Yeah.
You know, Thomas Hausigl, he's an artist in LA too, and he's just come out, but he was one of the pros. He was probably the most inspiring pro around. He kicked the other way, and I was really ripe for it, and I had definitely a different take. You know, we had very different angles, but you know, mine was probably a little maybe more meticulous or something, or more. Whatever, his is really, really bold, like a boxer. You're just like, boom, with plaster. He was like, here's what we're gonna do. We just laid down the plan. We're gonna do figures. They're gonna be awful, and no one's gonna like us for years. And then we're gonna kick ass. It was like, and it's pretty much his panned out that way. And he was right. It was like we were plunged in the most deeply unfashionable place you could be. Fortunately, Holland, they had their own little unfashionable thing going on. So you're right, it made it a lot easier. And it made it really helpful that there were a lot of these really sort of important conceptual artists like Jan Dibitz and Stanley Brown and Gail Harold and who were coming in and saying, that's really, you know, we don't need you to be rational. It's like, but you're like, they had like this mystical rationality to their work. It was so, you know, so impressive, and they kept encouraging. Every time I started doing some of these abstract paper things, and Divitz coming in and be like, "We don't need another Ellsworth Kelly." It's like, I'm not going to be Ellsworth Kelly. I'll show you what I did with Ellsworth Kelly, but it was an argument we had to keep. As soon as I turned away from the figurative, I got in trouble in a way. It was like. Because you knew that it was the word, it was the hardest thing. It seemed like the hardest thing you could do. It seemed the most embarrassing. It was silly. We seemed the most ill-equipped for it. Anyway, I don't think it could have happened in America. Frankly, I don't know. So this guy was very. This guy was key. This guy is totally breaking from the whole topographical thing. And this guy was like some kind of a diagram of creative action. This guy was one of those. I was talking to you about that ghost thing. This guy ghosted. I turned him around. I did the whole thing. It was on the floor, and I did this whole head kind of up. I had this very face-centered way of creating. And this was great because the face was fed up through the legs. It was like I started down in the legs and I flipped around and I just did this kind of network of things, which was kind of a motif that I did when I was like 7, I found out later. But it was about this kind of creative network and this pathways in the brain. So it was sort of like the face was being eroded by this nervous pathway, and then this sense of this inner guy holding himself up by his own nervous pathways was a total portrait of you know, the time, of probably still isn't to some extent. Then things, I got pretty skilled, and things got definitely a very fierce science fiction dimension started coming in. This guy's actually folded into a corner. He's about 15 feet high, folded into a corner with a hood over his thing. Let's see what I got. Here's a photo of my first big show at Stedelijk Museum, Amsterdam. And it was one of these fabulous museum rooms. I pretty much shoveled my whole studio into the room and tried to make a show. And it was, for the most part, it did not go very well. It was kind of a disaster. It was a great, looks great on the resume, but I nearly had a nervous breakdown. This is probably the only corner that worked out for me. And here it was like, it was one of those first things where really, the kind of thing that I would have come back to later, but to take pieces and to try to construct a space out of it. I wasn't forcing a picture, but there's quite a classical triangular structure. There's some sort of a vague relationship of characters looking at other characters. Just for this show, I turned that guy upside down. But all in the center, held by this sort of demonic. He has some little circle spinning off his fingers too. There's very often the kind of the evil draftsman characters kind of showing up, which is probably how I would want to rate myself in this group. He later got a mask. I made these. So the Ellsworth Kelly stuff evolved into these. I wondered if I could. I keep having these things where I specialize too much and then try to develop a way out of it, but. This was these sort of folded paper origami kind of mask with a photocopy. Very complex one, but can I make? Because I was always folding down the center, and I thought, well, can I make a fig? Can I make a face with only folded and no lines? So that was a whole very formal exercise. It took me. Skip to this now. So then I was finished with school. I was hanging around Holland, being invited to the various provinces, you know, out to do art shows, and kept doing these drawings, although definitely wearing on me, this symmetrical thing. It's probably on like year 3 or something, these symmetricals. And techniques keep evolving. In this case, I hung them in the show. I kept trying to find ways to give them more body in the show, to make them more spatial. This gives you a little. This is a little portrait in the studio. That's give you a sense of how big they were. They were too big. They'd run onto the floor. They were just these long scroll. So there's Art Joe a few years later, not looking so hot. Here's another version of the mask. So it was constantly this thing of like coming up with a linear structures that would be sculptural, and then coming up with sculptural things that would integrate with the drawing. So I'm definitely pushing a lot around with those formal things between drawing and relief, which is already happening with the little crumpled heads. But this was quite a haunting little guy that showed up along the way. It would tend to be, the more I did them, the more hit and miss they'd become. And I'd end up throwing out just like piles and piles. But they got harder, the good ones got harder to come by. This was quite a breakthrough that I didn't do much with. Probably because this guy just nailed it so hard that I couldn't do much with it. In this case, I altered the way the folds were made. So it's all symmetrical structures. But this is, I really was in my Baroque phase of the symmetricals here. It's like they start out in a classical period of, okay, nose, eyes, and then they move into this, pretty soon you're just doing clouds and puffs of smoke, and the line was taken to an extreme. This one was just like, I mean, super, you know, I made them with forks, so they were like, just these very shrill, and I think I was trying to lose the figure. I was really getting sick of the two arms, two legs all the time. I felt like there was something emotionally in the figure I had to stick with, but I just couldn't stand it. This guy was just like an insect, like his face had just molted off. This was just pure buzz. It was just like this virulent, buzzing force, and it's like, I don't always have to stick it with Grandpa's face, but this is definitely Grandpa showing up again. Certain guys, there's characters that show up a lot, no matter, I have a lot of tropes, and then I keep having to come up with these formal inventions to break the characterization. You can see the kind of the, I was really interested in the old master etching. This is where the folded masks led to. They're basically pleated material. Kind of a real sad Darth Vader character showing up here, but a very simple process, just with scoring of the back of a piece of paper. So it's just a single sheet of paper folded, creased at the edges. We don't want to miss those chins. So these were really, this was like another version of the symmetrical permutations, but a really good way to get away from all those curly cues that were taking.
How long did it take to make one of these? Like, just as far as the...
These are usually like kind of like the second draft. The first draft is, they get all hammered out because I'm pushing and pulling the paper and it starts to get floppy. So that then I sort of realize that I can go on the back and sort of make a map of how to end the concave and convexes. I might work a day on the rough draft. And they optimal change a bit. They're not terribly labor intensive.
How big in the end?
But they can pretty much be as big as I want them. These are about that big. Yeah. And they stick out about that far usually from the wall.
We usually do them in drafts, so you do one that gets thrown away first?
I do one, yeah, that usually because the hard edges get lost, from the, because some of the, like that, the outer things are just like, it's a very, they look very cruel in the end, but it's a real like wrestling, and it's such a tight set of rules. It's like a Rubik's Cube. You wanna break it and put the red on the red side, but every force in needs a force out, so. It follows these certain physical laws, which I think give it a sort of a harmonious something very reassuring about it, because it has to follow these, just the physics of the fold thing. I did it again. I can't keep my hands off this thing. Did I do it?
And go to the top bar there and scroll over and
control.
So
you just go. Yeah. You just want to use the arrow keys.
So yeah, find the one that you want to hit that, and then hit play at the bottom.
Yeah.
And
yes.
Then keep your cursor
save
off that bar, and
the
just use the right.
I never used the keyboard. I'm all like, it's got like, okay, excuse me.
Do you see these, out of all the work that you've showed us so far, do you see these just as individual projects, or do you feel in some way that, like with this work, that the stuff that came before it was ultimately arriving at this sort of destination, and this was kind of a synthesis of different ideas?
That's a good question, yeah, because you hammer away at stuff. I actually hit on these way early. I mean, I hit on these, and I kept doing the drawings And it did seem like absolutely I hit the jackpot. You know, this was a culmination. I mean, no lines required. Pure geometry. It was just like fantastic. And still getting, it took me a lot longer to get some of the expressive qualities. You know, it was quicker with the drawing to just be like, you know, than to get these imploded. You know, I was amazed at the expressive power I could get in there. Because as a technique, it was like, yeah, whatever. But if I can't get the expressive power in there, there's nothing to do anymore. But yeah, I did, and I really over the years, you do get these things like I hit it. That's my thing. And I think my latest, you know, breakthrough, say with a beginning in 2005 was, it's all good. You need it all. You need the flops in there. You need your, you know, in some way or another, there's your, the whole idea of this, like, you're getting to this modern, you know, these are the modernist, like, you got there, you've arrived. To get rid of that modern timeline was what got me doing figures in the first place. And so it was a really big deal, because I started to professionalize, you know, I got good at stuff, and, you know, I put on my gloves for these, and, which I'm not very good at doing, as you notice, my, you know, touchy stuff. But, I would, yeah, I professionalized these series, I got really hooked on these series. You know, this is what it really played out.
So I was wondering about the, when you mentioned doing the shifting to working in drafts, because it seemed like so the opposite of everything you've shown up before, where, you know, it's like the process of making it is certainly in there, but then you know, to have that thrown away.
Yeah, no, it was hard for me to, but this is some of the only work where the perfection of it, like somebody else should make these once I make them. Everything else I make is something that I can only do, but these I'd love to hand off to someone who's cleaner than me to do. And I still get them, like sometimes a collector will call, like, is it supposed to be like this? And I'm all, not really, send it back, dude. I'll like, I can do it clean this time. You know, they need to be super clean. You're right, yeah, there's no hesitation. Yeah. There's no drafting involved here. This was another weird period of paintings. I'm just showing all these, you know, highs and lows along the way. This is a really disgusting little bloody trophy guy. Something about his face got me, you know. So then you get attached. This is some kind of a Harley Davidson. These guys are huge. But this was a way to get more, again, like to keep the spontaneity and still have the body of it. Like to make a painting without a paintbrush. So starting to use the, you know, the blade. This is an interesting, another weird hybrid type of thing where they were still symmetrical, but they were based on fold. This is on flat folded things. So the paper was inked up and then printed, and then I unfolded the whole thing and printed that. So that second piece there is sort of like the full pattern of the other guy. So it was a very severe set of rules to play by, and a nasty technique. I did it for a year. I lived in Japan for a year, and I had a little garage I rented from some family, and I just pretty much made these all the time. I tend to get very addicted on these processes, like just, you know, these methods. But there's a few cool, you know, that a good way to break that line madness I was doing. But this was so interesting because they were like transformers because they. They had to be made of this by geometric rules, but these were quite large ones. This is these were two sheets. What are we saying? Like this? What is that? I don't know. 5, 6 by 6 feet. These I've not managed to file into my new collections at all. These are still secretly robes. That's one of them unfolded. It's like, ow. Ouch. But we did do this. This is a show that Laura Schnitger and I did. Laura's my wife. We came back from Japan and we did a show at the State of the Museum, the hometown museum again. And this was one of the best, like, corner. She had one of her, her pieces in it. We wanted to create this whole, like, we called this like the war corner. It was really influenced by the graphic traditions in Japan and this kind of samurai. I just thought this was a real visually powerful corner.
Do you feel like the autobiographical element in this work has been left behind at this point, as far as kind of looking back at the, you know, application to Cooper when you're 17 and basically manipulating this G.I. Joe figure to your sort of idea of what an artist was and using yourself as that image, and then into this, and now you're, at some point you started calling these guys, like, oh, this guy, that guy, and now what we're seeing is much more abstract and has become, you know, you mentioned mythology, and much more like a, almost like just a Joseph Campbell mythological masks or something, or archetypal masks.
Yeah, they definitely did. Yeah, I think the more rigid the formalism developed, the more, in a way, the more archetypal they started to, they're the more archetypal versions. Yeah, they're not much, you know, you don't see grandfather quite as much, your mom showing up. But there's always something I can kind of relate to. Even when they get, like, I kind of battle against the archetypal, too. There's something too rigid, too harsh about it. There's usually something that's slightly touching to me about them. That doesn't, I mean, against my better, sometimes visual power, it's just like, whoa, I could, what I'm capable of, technically, to do an archetypal sort of power image, then it doesn't. And I think that's kind of what happened with those Japanese ones. I think they didn't really move me much. Maybe that little gardener guy, that little orange guy. He had that. There's something a little bit slumped and damaged about the characters that get to me. It's a weakness, probably for the work. It's both a weakness and its signature, you know. So after all that geometry, I was just like, I am sick of the figure. And I just went into this period of, I don't know how long it lasted anymore. Weird period called just the charcoals. And it was like I took away most of the things that make it possible to make an image. Well, that's a great photo. Thanks a lot, dude. I was kind of like minimal line, no, very low contrast. Everything that gives an image its ability to see, I was like eliminating. Everything that was good about my work, this confrontational figure, get rid of it. Send him out to the woods, dude. I was so sick of these confrontations. I mean, I don't know if it's great work, but I'm relieved to see it right now. So this was a show I did at Anton Kern with, and I asked my old professor, Derek Harold, if I could do these. I wanted to make kind of like places more than these figures. Some place where the figure could get lost. I think, you know, the autobiographical side is always there. I wanted to get lost. You know, I didn't want to be working on the assembly line anymore in my studio. I wanted to wander through the dust again and see what I could find. It's like the little guy shining a light. Usually he does find another figure, but there's also rock formations where things emerge. I just wanted to see what would emerge. And these carpet pieces are bricks bondoed onto carpet. These very weird pieces that Georg did in the 80s. And I called him up and said, can I have some for my New York show? So I had this big New York, hey, your New York solo. And the gallerist said, I got a lot of floor space. You know? I said, well, why don't we do Harold's carpets? Oh, great, you got some of those? He's like, yeah, right. But I called him up after so many years. He was like, yeah, it's nice to hear from you. Can I have some carpets down? I said, yeah, you can have them, but you gotta make them. And I needed it as a, you know, all this wispy charcoal stuff. I thought it was a really great, like, materialistic, I think they're quite spiritual things, actually, but they're so base. You know, they're just like this crummy carpet and this brick, and they have this, like, just this really materialist poetry about them that I need. I feel like I needed to weigh. I think I needed more of them, maybe, for this show, but I saw them in these kind of really profane little rock gardens. I asked Eric if he saw that at all, and he just kind of like, absolutely no, you know. He was on the Autobahn or something in his head. But very generous to let me do it. End of the world. We were invading Afghanistan and bombing Bora Bora, and I was just out there with him, man. I was in my studio in LA, like, nobody knows me here. And we're at war. It just seemed like we were in 24-hour war, just blowing rocks up. And I was trying to find some kind of beautiful, like Chinese landscape in that destruction. And I went to do the show. I had a whole box of crumbs with me. I wanted to reintroduce the sculpture, and they seemed like little pebbles or something. They ended up in this box. I like this photo. It's very, that's base, man. Lucky the gallery didn't throw them out. Then, here we go, another personality showed up. So then I went to China. So by now I was getting pretty spun out. You know, I was doing LA disaster landscapes and, like, you know, Japanese stuff. And then I went to China and I was like, boy, the Chinese landscape is not like the Chinese landscape. It's an endless assembly line of construction and roads. So I developed this, again, as just like another breakthrough with the symmetricals to make this kind of multiple folded kaleidoscopic. So the piece, you know, you draw on these little panels, and the whole image was retransferred and fading as it went. So I was very excited to finally get a horizontal going in my work after all these verticals. Seemed like some kind of history lesson where things would rise and fall. And it's very much in this Chinese, this endless road of China. So I think for the little suite of drawings that it is, it's pretty sharp. And it's a nice contrast sometimes to the, this was sort of going into a temple and blowing up this Buddha head or something. I had this kind of these weird narratives, silly narratives in my head, but I was really into blowing stuff up and trying to chart this decay in this very clear way. This is sort of a Tiananmen Square thing.
Can I ask you a question about you traveled a lot. Like you said, like you mentioned, like, oh, like I went to LA and it was like nobody knew me here and the war going on. Like, is that, are you sort of intentionally trying to find places to, like, isolate yourself and then also just sort of be in a new environment? Just, like, talk about traveling.
I think it must be part of that, yeah. I mean, when you're given the opportunity to go to China for 6 months, you're like, you're going to take it,
yeah.
You know? And it was just, I kept feeling, I think I was really this student, being a student, going to learn, use the materials that are there, you know? And I just couldn't, but it does tear you apart. You know, you're at that smorgasbord of the world cultures, and you're just like, ugh. After a while, you don't know. But it's true. A lot of stuff was intentional to break patterns. You know, I broke out of that symmetrical stuff. It always did work to break stuff. It didn't always work to coalesce stuff. That took until quite recently that I was able to put stuff together and stop this. I used to go to a place and I would, you know, say, that place back there was terrible. You know, and then I'd go to the next place, that last place was terrible. This is the place. This is the work. This is the best work, you know. And you get a little perspective and things much better. You see this all dimensions of a story that you're working on, you know. One student in China asked me, he was like, sometimes you use shadow, sometimes you use line. Why? I was like, that's amazing. I had to come to China to do line. I go to, you know, I leave Japan and to do shadow. And then it's actually the world does, there's traveling in the real world and there's traveling in your work. And you're like, okay, I'm dealing with this. I'm dealing with these are now countries on their own. Some of them were more illuminated by different places. You know, the Asian tradition is this incredible certain kinds of light. Each place has a certain kinds of line traditions, origami traditions. But now they're just like corners of my studio are different countries I go to. And that's the best place to be right now.
Matthew, what was your relationship to the figure when you were doing these last two projects? It seems like there's this move to get away from the figure, especially this sort of singular, iconic figure that's kind of isolated from...
Yeah, I was really, really done
with it. But I know it's come back into the work, so can you talk a little
bit
about...
Yeah, he definitely made his vengeful return, but I think having but much better traveled than the character. The character is definitely broke, the figure is broken out of its... More in a way like the original ones I did that I began with, they broke out. The symmetry is frozen in space. You know, as soon as you get a three-quarter view, it's like all the space in the world is pressed against that edge, and that entrance in space, that hard, you know, these symmetrical guys were like these godlike things. And it's like, okay, you're coming down now. You're gonna go to China and work on the Chain Gang with me. We're gonna travel the world, and we're gonna, you know, and it was like they got stronger for that. You know, they developed in this sort of, you know, in almost that scientific chamber of the symmetrical. But then to pull them down and animate them is like they've been broken. But I'm sorry, I'm not addressing them. You're right. Those two attempts were really attempts to get away from it, to go out to try to. You know, to deal with crowds, like masses, like why this, you know, it's just, the world just didn't seem to be made of this artist alone in his studio all the time. So there was an attempt at more multiplicity, but I think I still kept coming up with this kind of this monotheistic or this empire symmetry again. You know,
I mean, you're thinking about the...
In the characters,
of the China drawings.
I'm sorry, the blue ones. Yeah, they still had this sort of empire, like they were crowds, but they had erased all the. And then when I tried to do that Tiananmen thing, you know, which was all about one guy standing in front of a symmetrical empire, you know, and I drew him, and of course he was immediately in some kind of Busby Berkeley formation. You know what I'm saying? This is not, and I had a good friend of mine say, you know, there's no, you know, they do call it asymmetrical warfare. It's like, whoa. And that just hit me, like, that just really, that blew me away, like, another reason to somehow identify my frustration with symmetrical warfare. And then I felt like I'd also relinquished a lot of my abilities on those pieces, it was neat that I could do them, but that individuality I've kind of relinquished to this neutral blueprint style drawing. So then I kind of came back with a vengeance again, trying to, I had a really devastating studio visit with Georg, the German artist from Gritz. And he said, well, you know, I had all these beautiful Chinese, I was coveting these things, you know, and he said, yeah, it's pretty good for a scarf. I thought they were political, you know? I was listening to NPR all the time. Like, you know, and the drawings have that monotonous, like, that monotone, like, good trickle of information kind of thing. And then Bush got reelected, you know, and I got told that I was doing scarves. Something just cracked, man. I was like, I give up. I'm not gonna be a good boy no more, you know? Just whatever power is left in me is, you know, it is, yeah, it's maybe it's G.I. Joe stuff. Maybe it's some kind of boyhood thing or whatever, but it's all I got. And I'm never gonna be convincing as the court reporter. So then I started, and then the goblins just started coming back, and they were very disgruntled about the state of the world. They're not happy about what's going on, and they would often the drawings start out very they often start out very like Roman, you know, very strong and a lot of stature, and then they end up like you know, when I start bending them around, when they enter the world, when they enter the three-dimensional world, it's a rough passage. I was thinking of, you know, I was just so saturated. It was constant news of these things being blown up, and then, you know, bombers, and then all the time this rationale of this sort of pseudo-rationale of this freedom building and all this stuff. And it was like, I don't know. I think I took a little tip from the Rumsfeld administration, actually. I sort of gave up on a liberal, paying attention in a liberal way. It just was like, man, if they can do what they want with fucking armies and bombs, I can do what I want in my studio now. I don't know what that, I don't know, but you get responsible sometimes in your studio. You start thinking you gotta make progress. So I just really I just looked in the dust, and I tried never to let things coalesce. I'd do one thing and I would just distract myself. I just tried never to let anything, I tried to stay out of the series and just be really just irresponsible and flighty and too intense here and lame there and dirty and let out all my worser qualities and just try to find a way to channel all my really bad qualities. In a way, or just not to edit them out so much. The things just started really piling up. Then I started, bits of stone from the landscape paintings have come flying out. You know, weird molten formations one day. Strange pieces of like gnarled, blown up buildings made of photocopies, they were in there. I took a trip to Tibet also, which pretty much, that really put me over the edge, because there's a religious, you know, just a totally, totally damaged religious empire that's, pretty much sat on by the Chinese, and kind of sad, kind of hysterical, too. It's not like you go and you realize yourself. I mean, it's like hardcore, like Buddhism and shamanism mixed on this really barren climate, and I felt like that's where art is right now. Like it's some kind of like weird desert religion that's just barely holding on. So I made this guy, this Sherpa guy, dude, he has an altitude, I think he's at Everest Base Camp. He's at 5,220 meters. I mean, I'm really just letting flow now. There's a lot of these psychedelic kind of associations, but that's what it was like up there at that high altitude.
Up to this point, you've shown like a real preference for using traditional art materials, folded paper, charcoal, the paint. But I remember from the very beginning of the series from Holland, you had some foam, some flower foam in there.
Yeah.
You feel like there's a particular preference you have for avoiding temporary materials?
Well, that's
or
floral.
Like,
that's floral foam.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I like a material not to be totally, well, that was part of the dogma, dude. No found objects. I wanted just to try to make it so it was kind of unsure what you were looking at, what the material was. It just seemed a way to make it more, just to have less reference point, less reference to time, to a specific time. I do use dollar bills sometimes. That's kind of the only one I really use. But a lot of foam, I mean, they're pretty much all foam. I guess I really embrace the irrational, sick, dark, some of the sick and dark aspects of the history of art, too, that it's pretty weird playing with, like, making figures, you're playing with some pretty spooky stuff, like, the recognition, the one-to-one again, there's voodoo in that process, especially when you have no reference point to ground yourself in. Is it Ian Curtis? He's one of the only guys that's like actually trying to do somebody else or something else. Like, I think I made him a little bit thick, but I got something right in that thing, you know. So you know, an ecstatic hero for me, one of these guys. You know, I'm seeing Artaud, these sort of, this kind of damaged visionary character is really the, is really is really somehow, you know, sometimes this is some sort of a Chernobyl guy, I think he showed. He's got that old Russian, like, I don't know, they come later, the associations often, but there's a lot of the damage that's been done to them is cultural, it's toxic. They've OD'd on various, they're saturated with, they're kind of poisoned by their own, like the silver powders I use and the pigments, and all the characters are kind of poisoned.
Matthew.
You're always dealing with these time references, and I don't know what's worse, to see old fashioned or to new brand spanking new or whatever. It's always there, but I try to mix the senses of time and distort the sense of time by multiplying them, not by some kind of like, you know, I don't know, they use the word timeless or something for my work, but that's a bit embarrassing. It's kind of a heavy. I do it sort of just trying to more by multiplying things, multiply the expressions, multiply the by a multiple history as some kind of accretion of the high and the low and the lesser. You know, there's noble materials mixed with weak materials. I do tend to like glass because it's as opposed to plexiglass. I like the green edge. I like the way that it's, you know, made from crushed sand. It seems to, you know, it's closer to dust. Things that, like the drywall, well, I'm getting there. So I got it to the point of being on this table. And then slowly you get into, okay, well, this little blackhead here, for example, he's got a little bit of a trophy stand. And slowly, how far can you continue the atmosphere of the piece into the presentation? Have it add to it. This is another. So some of these pieces, you know, kind of these crumpled paper stuff. This is one of those kind of like damaged modernist, like Russian modernist sculpture on the square or something. The kind of thing you'd see in a poor town in China made out of stainless steel. But this is just paper. So by putting it in the glass, you flatten it again. So there's all this effort to make it three-dimensional as a drawing. And then you actually make it really three-dimensional. And then you kind of try to flatten it again by putting it by hand glass. So often all these strategies are funny ways of like playing with the dimensionality, playing with them as images. So by putting something in a glass box, you elevate it and you protect it. But you also sort of kill it. And some of the pieces kind of needed to be killed off a little. They were a little too much upstarts. You know, they get like characters in my head. I'm like, you know, one way to control one is to, like, you know, you kick it around for a while, but you can also really strap it in a box and make the viewer go up and see it face to face. So there's nothing about like a neutral presentation, but as my presentation gets more and more aggressive. So that was one element. This is another element. The glass, for example, is broken in there, and then another glass box is made over it. This is the other part of the piece. So these are all these pieces which were initially flying around in my studio and ending up in this kind of formation. So a box is also becoming a shelf to support another piece. That hand is reaching out and breaking the view, trying to reach in and grab something in that other box. There's a stack of broken glass on that second tier there. The foam there on the left is exposed, and the glass is just stuck in it. So there's a little bit of a sense that, like, maybe you had a proper museum and somebody came in and kind of like they broke something. Maybe they took the important part of the sculpture off. Maybe somebody pulled a prank and put another piece on top of something else. Although this is a fairly stiff version of where things headed. And then, of course, the sheetrock, the drywall pedestal, really fit the thing of the crack, the cracked paper, the dust, all the pigments of dust, you know, because it's this kind of a diatomaceous earth in there. So it had this kind of real makeshift quality. So I wanted at the same time to like be like, okay, listen, I'm here now. Because I had made my first Daedalic show, I really made the problem of just like putting things on the floor, you know, and in a way I was pure on a poetic level. I was would only follow my energy as far as the image would take me. But it just they were getting lost in that. So it's like I had to stand up for myself and get things at eye level. And still try to give that presentation an energy that only I could give to it. So then that group then joins another group. There's Ian Curtis again. There's another grouping over there I'll get to. So that it was still very, you know, very hard edge compared to the studio, but you still got overlapping and a lack of hierarchy. Like you can never quite tell. It's important that, you know, you've got these very magnetic objects, but that the magnetism is multiplying, it's being distracted all the time. So, you know, I'll set up various tricks to actually underscore some tyrant that's emerged. Give them another, oh no, I did it again, what happened? Go away, go back to the keyboard. Oh, there we go. So this was the current, those were the pieces in the bag you pulled back. So it went on and on. And this show, you know, there's a lot of really special little pieces in there, but from a distance, you had a very strong impression of pedestals.
What year was this?
2005, I think. Yeah. And this was, I guess what you would say was pretty much my breakthrough show. It was my third solo with the gallery. But, you know, things had never hit before. Probably the good show that I did was in the beginning, but it was way too early with some of these symmetricals. Actually, Joshua Dechter included one in the show. Mm-hmm. If I ever see him again, I'll thank him for that. I lived on that for a year. Like, yeah, I did this. You know, you take it where you can get it. That's great. So here you see boxes with the old Chinese drawings just wadded up and thrown in there. All this kind of surplus and all, so everything, nothing was off bounds, out of bounds. Nothing in the archives was safe. And it's just like, if I can't make something, you know, I got nothing to lose here. Fortunately, you know, I didn't lose. It had an impact. You know, I mean, I could critique this, I could attack the show for a long time now, but you do that with the work instead of the words.
Could you talk a little bit about creating a fictional history? I keep thinking of like the Natural History Museum or something, or museums in general, and the relationship between creating like fictional history and sort of rejecting, in a certain way, like art education and spending a lot of time by yourself making this stuff, and how that, I'm feeling a kind of a relationship between like generating a kind of history of art or something.
I think so. I don't know if I set out to do it, like I'll do the Byzantine stuff now or whatever, but when you set this task for yourself with those kind of my little rough set of rules about, you know, how I'm going to make these figures, you hit these things. It's amazing. You know, if I'm just, even in just the course of a couple hours drawing, like you travel, it's a time travel thing. You come up with, you know, you might start with this Oscar Schlemmer formalist thing, and then you smudge it a bit, and you start to move into the Greeks. And they're not that far away. There's certain formulas, there's certain that take you places. It's really amazing. You know, I didn't think of, you know, some of the, the thing that's always been important to me is to somehow be there first, to feel like I'm a little bit there firsthand. That's always been the history. History's great because, yeah, history, I've taken history as a huge ride, man, as I've turned it into this total joyride, as opposed to this oppressive thing that it was somehow taught as. And one of my transformation moments was just like zigzagging through the antiquities of the Louvre, just like on hashish. You know, and it's like, if I can get some of that kind of absolute wonder and shock at these things that didn't seem old at all to me, something, some hallucinated version of history, as in terms of the art school, yeah, I mean, I think by now I'm not, you know, I'm not quite fighting it off as much, you know. It's definitely unmoored and I'm out sailing, but I do hope that there's a generosity in the possibilities that it opens up for seeing other art, older things, because they're just not like think they are. You know, they're just not like you think. And maybe I have to whoa, dude, so got interrupted. I didn't do anything.
Move the cursor around. Maybe it just lost the signal from the computer.
In
the space bar.
The battery
is on. Space bar. Yeah, is your computer plugged in?
No. Uh oh.
Morris, do you have your lecture plan?
Yeah, that's the same thing. Yeah, but you know what's
sometimes I feel like I am trying to make an entire civilization myself, and you do need to have your scarf makers, and sometimes a year making scarves, that would be fine. You know, you don't always have to make the centerpiece. That was also a very freeing up thing to me, if I had a mood to do some little architecture experiment or whatever. There was now a place for it. There's one of the scarves. Actually, a really kind of beautiful drawing that ended up just as this kind of sash hanging there. And there's a drawing pressed into a box. So there, the glass box is really like that. That's the only way you could get the drawing to do that. And there's that old original little rat character showed up. And there's a little this little kind of rough. Fossilized figure is holding up that piece of glass. So there's a kind of a real precarious thing, but this I think was getting away from just that pure accumulation. The collection is really how they started, and it seemed like nothing next to each other, everything next to each other just was great. It just seemed like your mind could jump and make its own connections. But more and more I got interested in like counterbalance and balance and character-wise, like, was it different versions of the same different incarnations or character persona and transformation? You know, different.
Can I ask a question about how it's changed the way you made them? Like, if you made these things out of all these old projects and sort of different directions you had been going. You make elements for new pieces, knowing that they're going to be elements for new pieces? Does it change the way you think about when you make them?
I think sometimes I put less pressure on a piece to be final, and I'll let them stew. You know, some pieces I'll just, like I said, I'll get in a mood, and then I'll stack up, and I can just see big pile over the studio, and be like, that was January 2004, man. Like, what's over there now? And they'll age. So there's a lot of things like, you get that patina and stuff. You're like, well, they're just really poorly treated and they age. It's like, I feel like sometimes I'm like a cook with a lot of stews. Definitely not a sushi chef. You know, not the Fred Lara, my wife, she's the sushi chef. But I'm like those old stews where you've got to have the burnt pan, you know, and it's burned with lard and then you throw in another. And my sensitivity for color and stuff is very much like, oh, we need a hint of this, or it's quite dainty, and it's like, and very much of a lot of taste is involved too, like tonalities that will unify pieces, but yeah, you're right, it takes the pressure off that, which is great, because it's very nice, and then they'll have new incarnations. Generally, with a carving, with a straight into the block stuff, the pressure's on. You know, I have to go start to finish with those. But a lot of elements, like drawing elements, and those are less pressurized. There's just that blue thing was an abstract. That was part of a whole series on its own. It could have been a nice just on the wall, but and the way that it just plays off that figure is again all ways of spinning out of the figure, like the gesture. I saw it as some kind of a star map. I mean, it really doesn't matter often what I'm thinking. It's a sensitivity-wise, gesturally, that watered up thing there animates or is some a graceful echo of Ian that Ian there is.
Matthew, can you talk a little bit about the kind of recognition of the pedestals and your kind of move with drywall and kind of owning the pedestal a little bit, like how that played
I'm taking more and more ownership of the pedestal. I mean, initially, like, and there's a lot of it's just practical, like shipping. You know, these galleries didn't want to ship these things because, I mean, they're just like the word, they're heavy and they're brittle. I mean, all artists, I think, get to know sheetrock because of, or drywall because of, like, settling studios. So you get pretty good, and I was like, God, this material is just so weird. There's something here. And there were already features, like I said, the features of it with the paper and the dust were all features I really liked. And the printing, there's like a printing that goes around and it's broken by the white of the, you actually can't get this color anymore, Grieve said. These black ones. Black? We don't have black. It's drywall. The drywall has color. No, it doesn't. The hardware store stuff, through New York City, like. So I'd go to New York, and we spent like 2 days making all these pedestals. And at my studio, there was no way I could have all these pedestals. Now I have a slightly bigger studio, and I'm really like living with these things, living with the pedestals more. So they start to take on more of the nicks and dings, and think I could replace these, or that's just right. I'm actually starting to spray paint on them, printing on them, gluing drawings to them. So slowly, I've done things with them broken. I've done things, and they're real role playing again. They're all made from the 4x8 sheet. So it's like the masks where you've got to deal with the standard sheet and all the permutations of that. I've dropped ones. I'll get to some of those. This is one where in a way the central figure is actually just like a necklace hanging off the side, and the other one is sort of like a collapsed. This one's called Dictator Equator. It's kind of this really Stalinist like red hand, and then these strange little bits of like possibly broken modernist buildings with this crazy little like tribal drawings inside it, and then this kind of silly voodoo figure hanging off the side. So that was one of the first ways I was still, it looks kind of timid to me, but it was breaking out of the figure. It's some, again, it's some kind of assertion of this like view, this rational top, and so here I found just different ways to kind of give them some landscape or crud. I don't want to make scenes. I don't want to make like those little army guy scenes where they're in a little thing. But I mean, this is approaching it, but still, you don't have any idea exactly what. I liked an element that there's another. Nice drawing in the back and the bottom of that one. So there's an element of storytelling, but never really a scene making. I'm more interested in the objects that might have accompanied this character, or you know, or maps, or you know, sort of reliquary fragments of this experience, of this character's experience. Like there's these sort of these asteroids. Straight, this guy's definitely gone mad, but. He's definitely been eating too many rocks or something. You know, there's somehow this whole schism that I was going with the landscape and the figure. It was like these guys are created by the landscape. They've ingested the landscape and been scarred by it. And the presentation is just, it's one of the only ways you can get just a piece of paper. Just to be held in that position without like stiffening. So just all those traditional ways of presentation are such a good way to preserve these delicate accidents. This was a funny little story. This is a guy, yeah, here's the, oh God. That was an assignment for my wife. I had a night at a bar one night where I turned into a heckler, which is so not me. I was heckling this guy, like, I don't know, the vodka was just, it was horrible. And then Laura was like, that was the worst night, dude. She gave me the assignment, was like, you're gonna do the heckler. So that was the heckler I did back there. And the heckler was given a $5 tip at the bar just to show off. But this is poor old Lincoln. Definitely, it's like if he went to the Civil War himself, he'd end up there. He was part of that group. But this is a little invention I came up with when I was like 15 to like wrap the Army guy with a dollar bill. I played with Army guys for a rather long time as a child, but it had all the crumpled head stuff was already in there. His little smile, his little smirk got better with the crumple. I've taken it up to the $100 bill. I don't know what's going on. This is some kind of Amelia here. This is some kind of a like lady, like hair. Very difficult for me to do women, to say. The very best I ever come up with it usually is an androgynous character. It's definitely one of my kind of, I might have to, I don't know. I'm not really gonna go into that topic. I don't know, I think it's, my friend says it's just because you're such an incredible narcissist. That's relaxing.
So Matthew, do these characters evolve through the materials as you work with them and through your process, or do you have this idea of like, you know, doing a heckler?
I mentioned these because there's a few assignments I have. I had Ian Curtis, I had the heckler. Who else have I done? Not very many. I almost never have a preview. So it makes, and I never have a plan. Not having a plan, so you end up, the head is this big, and then you're working along, and you're like, I mean, you know, the Egyptians very, very intelligently did a graph along the whole thing. They graphed out the proportions that had these class. And I'm always just like, let's go and see what happens. And with drawing, you know, there's of course, you know, erasure, but with sculpture, subtraction, there's nothing but subtraction. You're constantly, you know, you're scraping away, so, hey, it's just silly things, but these things totally occupy, I mean, this is mostly what I think about. It's like, you've got to, the side of the block is here, or say the nose. You want the nose to be sticking out the furthest? You've got to think of the edge of the block as the end of the nose. So, where do your characters come from? The tip of the nose. It's just like, they come from these very strange, and then I put it someplace, it breaks, then I gotta repair it, then it looks like they went to war. So it's not to be like, you know, la-di-da about it, but it's an incredibly, their story is really like this living story in the studio. Along with all the other weird objects around, just simply to get the urges, these urges I have when I'm going along, I'll finish a day, I'll think, that's quite stately. I really enjoy. I'm really quite talented. I come in the next day and I'm like, you fool. And it's like the eyes are just whatever. The mouth is just infuriating. So I'll just cut the jaw off. I mean, like radical surgery. It's quite a. And then you just stab a stick in there. And it's like, it's kind of a brutal process. I sometimes have a feeling like, well, they see better without eyes, or they can't talk unless I've broken their jaw a little bit. Or that's kind of the voodoo dimension of it. Like, it's that you're not convinced of it as an image, so you actually have to perform it. You've got to stick your nose, this is sculpture stuff, you can do that. You can stick your fingers in the nose and be like, breathe now. It's goofy, but to some extent, and then you feel a bit of pity for it. A pity, firstly, that you've wasted your whole week on that, and the whole thing's turned to dirt on you, but here's a funny, you know, weird eye thing. This is definitely a real Trump, you know, one of these Trump-y-law jokes, or at least one of these, somehow a bit of ornament rising from the, now it's called Yesterday's News. This is a real show off. I don't know if I could let this guy stand now, but it's kind of the last piece of my Anton Kern show, and it was exciting because it was so big. And I had all these little itsy bitsy things, Curiosity Cabinet, and everyone was, you know, that was interesting, but this kind of this huge thing, it was so simple, it was just a curve. It's really just a curved piece of curved paper. And that became really the origin of my next, Jesus, what a show. Okay, here we go. So so then I got excited about the paper. I had another show coming up without, you know, where I didn't have 10 years to work on it. I only had about, you know, 6 months. So I wanted to make sort of large gestures again. So I went back to the drawing. Here you see these original, but in the back you start to see the contrast with these larger, so I kind of went back to the drawing board. Here's a lot of large smoothies I made. This is one of those shadow. Now it's time to use shadow. Shadow is good for you know, obviously for depth and illusion and this. So these, so I got interested in, you know, trying to make these larger and combining them, bringing out more of the, where's that guy again? Really getting weird into the kind of the mannerist distortions that could happen by this little simple curve. I'd done the crumple thing, but this was a fairly new, this is a view from my show in Amsterdam. Velter's gallery. So it was a great way to get like this massive, these kind of floating volumes just by laying a big drawing on top of a pedestal. And then, so you had a lot of this play of like the thick and the thin. I don't know if I totally got the balance right everywhere, but a couple of pieces I think I got it pretty spot on. This one in particular, really, this guy was so cruddy, and this one was such a naive, kind of smooth. So that contrast that I could get much easier in drawing was. This is one where a really large drawing, so the pedestals are getting a little smaller here. Really large drawing, oh, you can't see the back. It's a really, maybe the next one. Right here, this is the Berlin bike. And the room was amazing. I don't know if Ali told you all about it, but it was in this old school for Jewish girls, which had some pretty hardcore history, as you might imagine. And it was, and then it was taken over by the the GDR. And the lights, the fluorescent lights there, like, were exploding, and this weird hot oil was coming out. It was like, the assistant guys were all, yeah, that's really GDR. Like, I don't know, when do you feel like a thing with hot oil? Very Eastern. I keep on trucking here. Yeah, there's a pretty clear example of, so it looked like a very thin piece of paper could hold up something heavier. And spatially in the room, it got much more interesting than the current show because the distortions were really interesting. Then I was like, well, can I make bigger things out of foam also? So then I started, you know, seemed the obvious next problem. And I kind of found a bigger foam to use. Okay, that was the biggest foam guy. He's still mostly about things. But I was very pleased that I was able to get some of the shattered intensity in the bigger guys as the smaller ones. And that was great, you just did a whole saw. You had to think, doing bigger things, you have to think in a bold, in a bolder way. There's another one where, so this was again another about face, the next show, none of those big charcoals, but trying to get, another frustration from the current show was there were a lot of people I could show an individual piece and be, hey, that's a great piece. And I was like, well, you were standing right in front of it. But with all the crazy things, there was no aside. So here I was really trying to feature these more individual. And here, say the drawing, see his pants. The Chinese drawings are entering his pants. Some of those geometric paper pieces is kind of entering this armor in his shoulder. And here's a piece where, this is the beginning where one full sculpture is supporting another full sculpture. I almost wish I had the gall to just put it right on the floor in this case, but I wasn't ready yet. But the foam is basically the same proportion as the pedestal. And that's a painting. I did a whole series of paintings. That ended up being this kind of drapery. Similarly, one of those soccer, this is definitely a Socrates character or something. Poor guy. This was just so kitsch, I had to turn it upside down. There's sometimes you think, can I do this? And then you think, oh my God, I've done like. When you get some skills or whatever, you just. There's things on the level of taste that are kind of a little bit shocking to me. I'll make the whole thing gold. And then I come back and I think, what? And it's like a challenge, like a dare to myself. Can you deal with all that gold? But it always ends up pretty drab. So here then the glass is getting bigger. So the glass is starting, the vitrine is taking over the pedestal function. And here's a real makeshift kind of glass supporting. This was a whole group. This was one of the first times where a piece was involving two pedestals. It's like a shell. This is a shell. It's a whole special casting process. See here.
Matthew, where are we time-wise here? Are we, is this 06 or?
I think so. Yeah. It was a very fast succession of shows, of solos. So there, part of the torso is supplanting. So you have this kind of phantom limb. Somehow the pedestal taking on like a phantom limb character. One of the old drawings showed up in there. Perhaps somehow it's maybe a same dimension. Again, another stack, one figure supporting another, maybe possibly a this is maybe the most dramatic one. The glass was starting to fill in, because when you start from a complete block and you carve, so now the glass is starting to fill in where that original block used to be. It's like redrawing the limit of it. This guy went gold digging and just didn't come out on the right end. I have a feeling there's a lot of wealth, like kind of weird like treasure imagery. It's like these dollar bills and these kind of these little bars of gold. And there's sort of a failed search for wealth too. Like the tragic panhandlers. And there's times in the art world you feel like that too. Collectors like gold stuff, though, I have to say. Here's one where the pedestal, the figure's sunken in, so you don't see it at first. But he's laying in there, just more permutations. This was at the Hammer, so we're getting pretty recent. So those were older pieces, but I showed it with the Chinese and thought it was an interesting contrast. Thought they deserved to. It might, as with the crowd versus the individual. This is getting ready for the Mocha show, just like getting through the bit. Oh no. Here we go. Back to the drawing. I think I got it this time, guys. Sorry, we're really almost there. So here you can see before I get out the rest of my bag of tricks, it's pretty classical, just the carving and the block and stuff, that big hand down there. And like I said, like I was trying to say, you know, with the nose, it's like if the finger's wrong, it's too long, or so that you know, it has to come, it clenches in. So you end up with a palsied hand just because you're working on the proportions, but there's no way to extend the piece. Anyway, and then if I want to move the thumb, well, I pretty much just have to slash the whole block. This is a piece in progress. Let's just give you the whole. That's an 8 foot, 8 by 2 by 2.
What is that material?
It's a polyurethane foam. And it's got some, you can sand it. It's very, very, very nice if you like that kind of unpleasant material. It's a lot easier than styrofoam. It's harder in a way than styrofoam, but you can sand it. So you're working it like sandstone. So this is sort of what I was hoping the show would feel like, but it definitely didn't end up that way. I'm still really trying to digest what happened there in Mocha. There were some things I liked, but a lot of things are just was not what I was thinking. But it's maybe a little too early for me to proclaim. Anyway, here just thinking if I got bigger, I could get rid of the pedestal. The piece is becoming more pedestal on their own. I didn't really pull it off yet, but wanted to really just add to the confusion of what was, here's where that one ended up. That one ended up with, that's getting rid of the most, so that the head itself is a shelf, and there's this really strange, crumpled figure sleeping on it. I thought that was one of the stronger, and it was, this piece went through just, it was started out as this, like, Michelangelo dying slave, like, tell, it was just, it was so impossible. It had gone so deeply wrong, and I just slowly hammered him down until he got dwarfed. Big chunks taken out of him as he went along to, like that proportion correction. Michelangelo, Isaiah. Here's one. Yeah, the pedestal is almost gone, but it's really using the, this is a new thing I'm doing now where I use these straps, like for using your truck, just to strap glass onto the foam. And it's sort of a way where just screwing with the whole vitrine pedestal, the vitrine is the pedestal. I think that's where I'm headed, into some really precarious stuff with big glass. There's that old drawing shows up again. There was one. That guy didn't have a pedestal. This was an interesting, you can't see it in this, but this one was actually strapped with the, as if the pedestal was the main piece, and then this one was like strapped on the side, like an added additional thing. And this one, there was printing on a pedestal. This one was that whole piece you saw earlier, but it ended up getting hacked, turned upside down. This was one taking one of those old Chinese drawings and wrapping it around. All different attempts. I'm still not sure which ones I'm going to pursue. But here, this one is massive one. I just turned it basically into a coffee table. Sort of a Death in the Maiden finale. I think that's it. Oh God, no, then there's this one. Yeah, this is a weird piece, but this is a big move in that the head was separated, so that as you move in the room, the head moves visually in between them. So possibly to start having figures, made of chunks spread out. As scale changes, it changes everything. And the scale of that room at MoCA was maybe a bit much to bite off, but a couple of discoveries came out of it. All right, I'm gonna open it up to questions. Or if anyone's reports before we're done, I don't know.
I have one question. You talk a lot about, you mostly talked about your work sort of as like this like narrative of like the changes you made, right? Which is and but then you've stuck to like seems like the same textures and pretty much almost the same materials like the whole time. That seems to be the one thing that you never really like you didn't even mention like considering change it almost except for that initial thing with the masks and it had this like radically different thing. And like when I got to the point where you saw like you introduced that more specialized kind of foam, you know, the work in progress you showed, and like in my head I was like, well, why not like sandstone?
I'm not against it. It's just, I think, if I could keep the energy and speed and the freedom of it, be fine, I think that's the key. I don't know if, materials, it's not like they have a lot of inherent meaning. It's not like I'm trying to talk about bees or something, or have some, it is pretty magic, and it smells great, and stuff like that, but I'm messing with like I said, these weird straps now and spray paint. It's just that it's if I can just find a way to truly make it my own way of handling it, to handle it in a special way, feel then it's fine. I mean, I could probably handle it. Yeah, shipping would be tough, but they overcame the sheetrock, so we could probably do sandstone.
Was it sort of like, because you seem to really like the floral foam, and then I guess you just got to the point where it just wasn't made in big enough sizes? That's what I interpreted your
That's part of it. I still work with it for smaller things.
Was there sort of disappointment where like you couldn't like...
Where I couldn't get a huge piece? Like, well, the other problem is that to soak it with the wax, like I only have a pot so big, and it's really weird, because it's really light and super fragile. Then you soak it with the wax and it's wet and you lift it out and all kinds of stuff happens. It cracks and then it has to cool. It's very brittle. It's got a lot of, on a small scale it's okay, but bigger it's a nightmare to work with. I like it. I generally feel all nightmares. I'm like, okay, you want to crack now? All right, that's cool. I'll get out of the epoxy.